Hey guys, welcome back. In the last two videos, we saw installing the sub panel and wiring it, and also wiring up our outlets, 120 volts and 240 volts. In this video, we're going to be doing the DC side. Let's get started. See what we got. Going across the top here, we have some MC4 connectors for the solar panels. We have some circuit breakers for the solar panels, DIN rails, cable clamps, wire cutters, our battery lug crimpers, battery lugs, our battery cable, a 1000 amp DC bus bar. This is the Lynx Power In, very nice unit, a sticker, a T-class fuse, and a pair of 200 amp Nader DC rated breakers. Okay, the first thing we're gonna do is mount our Lynx Power In bus bar. These are nice because they're expandable, and each bus bar can handle four devices, four ins or four outs, depending on how you wire it. If you need more, you just add another bus bar. You take these boots off here, and you add another unit over here, and you just keep on stacking them. So the Lynx Power In is not a fused bus bar, unlike the Lynx Distributor, which has fuses. This is the same design as the Lynx Distributor, but without the fuses. There is a hack you can do to add fuses to this, just some nuts and bolts, and you add it here, and then you can add fuses to this. We'll do that in another video. I highly recommend running fused bus bars when you're running multiple batteries, because you're going to have equal length cables going to the bus bar, and each battery will have its own fuse. It's just a much better design. Now that we've got the bus bar installed, we can install our breakers for the inverters. So these are sold by Signature Solar, and they come with these lugs right here. These lugs are only good for 1-aught cable. We're using 2-aught cable, so we cannot use these lugs. You can remove the lugs, and you can install battery lugs like this. So for the best connection, you want to have your lugs like turned like this way. That'll cover the whole surface area of the lug. If you connect it like this, even though it looks nicer, you're losing out on all this connection right here. So if you're going for the best connectivity, you're going to want to turn it to the side. So if you're using LiPo 4 batteries, a 48 volt battery at 2.5 volts times 16 cells, that's going to be 40 volts. So at 40 volts, 6500 watts divided by 40 volts, you're going to be pulling 162 amps. This is called a DIN rail. All you got to do is pull these tabs like that, slide it on just like that. Or you want to really put these in like this, and then once you hook it on, that'll stay on there. I'm still looking for a box for this, so yeah, I'm gonna have to get a box because you don't want it moving around like that. But I'm gonna strap the wire down so it won't be able to move. This wire cuts pretty easily, the sheathing. Alright, so even though we're crimping 2-aught cable, I'm using the 1-aught plus, so it's slightly smaller than a 2-aught, and that'll give us a better bite on these lugs. Because I tried a 2-aught and I wasn't satisfied with the bite, so I went down one tiny size smaller. First thing you want to do is put your lug in, and if you get these flared lugs that have this flared flange like that, they won't fall through the crimpers, so it makes it really easy to do. You just want to hold it. You don't want to start crimping it. You just want it to be held in place, just like that. Should be able to put this right in here. You want to set it down on the surface so that you can force. You want to be pushing the cable into the lug while you're crimping and moving it back and forth like this. So I'm going to do a few crimps, move it, few crimps, move it, few crimps, move it. I'm going to put it down on the surface and really crank it good. That one size smaller actually cut into the, it starts pinching the wire like that. So you want to be careful not to pinch it too much, because you'll create a sharp spot. that can cut through your insulation. Alright. Yeah, so if you start with a 2-0 and then grip it once with a 2-0 and then go down to the 1-0 plus, you'll get a very good crimp without any burrs. That's really good. It's very tight. That ain't going nowhere. Only buy a heat shrink that has the adhesive inside of it. That'll help to literally glue the heat shrink to the rubber. It definitely will not come off. So you want to put it right there, right to the edge there. Not like that. Right there. This takes quite a bit of heat to heat this stuff up. This is 3-to-1 heat shrink, so it'll go 3 times down its size. It's really awkward because I'm trying to show you guys. It's hard to get a good bite on it. That's pretty tight. That's really, really tight. On the chopping block. This cable pushes the limits of these cutters. Ugh. Whatever you do, never use these. These are just junk. I thought these were good at one time and I used to use these, but they're just a pain in the ass. The metal is thinner, so when you use the dies on these crimpers, it doesn't get a good crimp because the metal's thinner and it never doesn't fill up the gap. It's a very fine line. But yeah, these are junk. Don't use them. Now I'm using the 1-0 plus. Okay, for these inverters, it's a 5/16 as well. The negative is on the right side and the positive is on the left side. Here, to finally make our busbar connections. Lands right here. Washer. Lock washer. And nut. Now I can put our positive on top. For the wire clamps, we've got these rubber wire clamps. Do not use metal. We want rubber on rubber. This one holds it just good enough. Look at that. Victron gives you copper lock washers. That is awesome. Come on, you gotta talk to it. Come on, please. See? You gotta talk to it. That's what my uncle would say when we were working on a car. And you got a bolt in a really difficult place. Can't even see it. You just got your arm down on the grease hole somewhere. Gotta talk to it. Alright, this bus bar is insane. I'm proud to own such heavy metal. I'm gonna have to polish that thing. Tighten it as much as you can, like holding the wire. Let go of the wire and give it a good crank. Alright, perfect. So I ran out of heat shrink tubing. I'll have to come back and fix that up later. Alright, so I went back through and cleaned up the DC wires because they were kind of messy. But now, all we have to do is install our breakers for our solar. Okay, this is the HT 5-way
breaker box, you can put two double pole breakers in here on the DIN rail and a single pole breaker. We're only going to be putting two double pole breakers in this box. Yeah, fit right in there. Just like that. That little ridge there actually keeps the bolt from moving. So cut it right about there. So you cut it too short, well, you're screwed. So these breakers do better with heavier gauge. I'm using 12 gauge for this line because it's only one string of solar panels, so it'll be like 10 amps max, so it should be fine as long as it's tight. Breaker on the left is going to be a 25 amp breaker. It's going to have 8 gauge coming in and 10 gauge going out. Should fit just like that. Crimp her down. Should look just like that. Take your connector. Put your wire through there. Put your pin in there. Just like that. It shouldn't come off once it's in there. Put it back on there. It goes just like that. Just like that. And crank it down. That should be good. Okay, here we have our 8 gauge PB wire. This is about 2,000 watts of solar. And we have our 12 gauge PB wire. This is about 1,000 watts of solar. Okay, I disconnected the solar, so we should have no power here. Yep. Completely dead. Completely safe. All right, turn the solar back on. Now we can probe our breaker, see if we got power. Should have about 120 volts DC. That's good. Okay, now we can put our cover on. Good. All right, we got all the DC side done. We got the battery done. We got the solar done. Ready to fire it up. So stay tuned for the next video because we're gonna fire it up and see if everything works. See you on the next one.